Halloween is right around the corner, making it the best time of year to binge some of our favorite scary movies. However, no one does horror quite like the master himself, Stephen King, who has written some of the most terrifying novels that still hold up today. So today on Top 10 Beyond the Screen, I'm going to be counting down our list of the top 10 scary Stephen King movies you need to watch this Halloween. And of course, there are so many iconic adaptations to choose from, I unfortunately had to leave some out. So honorable mention goes out to The Shining, Cujo, and It Chapter 2. Also, before we begin, be sure to stick around until the end of the video where I'll be responding to some of your comments. And with that, let's jump in. Coming in at 10, The Mist. Now, The Mist is a film that is a hit or miss for most people, but I absolutely love it. And in my opinion, it has one of the greatest endings of all time. Quote me on that. Released back in 2007 and based on the Stephen King novella of the same name, the film takes place after a powerful storm that damages the homes of Maine forces David Drayton and his young son to head into town to gather food and supplies. However, not long after, a thick fog begins to roll in and engulfs the town, trapping the Draytons and other locals in the grocery store. However, terror quickly mounts when a deadly creature is revealed to be lurking within the fog and killing off the residents. Now, this is one of the more overtly sci-fi adaptations of King's writing, and perhaps one of the most suspenseful and riveting, with, like I said, the ending becoming infamous all on its own. Now, what makes this movie so effective is that it expertly mixes the supernatural with human paranoia, with neighbor turning on neighbor, and a haunting conclusion that will leave you emotionally drained and distraught. In at 9, Christine. Directed by John Carpenter, Christine is a 1983 horror based on King's novel of the same name. The film follows the changes in the lives of Arnie Cunningham, his friends, his family, and his teenage enemies, after Arnie buys a vintage 1958 Plymouth Fury named Christine. This horror is a warped and wicked tale, and on top of that, it has one of the greatest soundtracks. I mean, John Carpenter movies always do. Have you guys seen Escape from New York? It's amazing. Anyway, though a film from the 80s, the visuals still hold up, with the titular scene, which shows the car repairing itself, becoming absolutely legendary. The premise of the film may seem cheesy and ridiculous, but in practice, it is truly horrifying, with the possessed car becoming one of the scariest villains to grace our screen. Not only that, but the way King and Carpenter managed to turn the love a guy has for his car into something horrifying and twisted is what truly makes this film so effective. In at 8, Pet Sematary. We're talking the 1989 version here, not the trash that was the 2019 remake. It's truly horrendous, guys, and like I said in my review of the film, sometimes dead is better, and that remake is dead. Anyway, this supernatural horror is an adaptation of Stephen King's 1983 novel of the same name, and follows Dr. Lewis Creed, who moves his family to Maine, where he meets a friendly local named Judd Crandall, who introduces Lewis to the Pet Sematary and the supernatural ground near it, which possesses the ability to bring the dead back to life. However, when they return, they are never the same. They never are they? Now, Pet Sematary works because it isn't just a horror. It's also a terrifying and all too real depiction of grief, posing the question to viewers, if you could bring someone back from the dead, would you? This is of course what goes down in the movie when Lewis's son Gage is killed and comes back as a murderous, soulless monster. However, he's still just a child, right? He looks the same. It's haunting and terrifying, especially if you're a parent, to watch an innocent child become a monster. A monster that feels no emotional attachment to you or anything else for that matter. All they know is to kill. In at 7, Gerald's Game. Gerald's Game is one of the more recent releases on our list, but it took me and a lot of people by surprise when it showed up on Netflix seemingly out of the blue back in 2017. And I can safely say that there are some moments of that film that I still think about today and can't help but grimace. Makes me feel sick. The film was directed by Mike Flanagan, the man behind Hush, and of course, the absolutely terrifying The Haunting of Hill House. The movie is based on Stephen King's 1992 novel of the same name and stars Carla Gugino and Bruce Greenwood as a married couple staying in an isolated house during a holiday. However, during a kinky game, the husband dies of a heart attack, leaving his wife handcuffed to the bed without the key and with no hope of rescue. Gugino's performance is truly one of her best, if not the best, with her character forced to battle her inner demons while facing the facts that she may never be rescued. The movie is incredibly smart, and that is in part due to Mike Flanagan, who managed to make every small moment seem like an important piece of a puzzle. Now, I don't want to spoil too much of this film because, unlike the rest of our list, not many know the ending, and it is the ending that will one day become so iconic iconic, like the rest of our list, because not only is it haunting, but also bloody, emotional, and incredibly powerful. Give it a watch, you'll not be disappointed. In at 6, Creepshow. For those who don't know, Creepshow is a 1982 anthology directed by George A. Romero and written by Stephen King. Quite the duo, right? The film itself is a compendium of 5 short tales contained within one single full-length feature, and oh boy is this film terrifying, and perhaps one of the finest horror anthologies to ever grace our screens. Now the film is one part horror and another part comedy, inviting us to laugh while simultaneously screaming from behind our hands. Although hailing from the 80s, the film still holds up, with the quality of all the shorts consistent across the board, with even Rotten Tomatoes giving the film a 73% approval rating, with one review stating, I quote, "It's uneven, as anthologies often are, but Creepshow is colorful, frequently funny, and treats its inspirations with infectious reverence." There you have it, Creepshow. Watch it. In at 5, Children of the Corn. Now it may be hard to believe me, but The Children of the Corn is genuinely a well-made and terrifying horror movie, unlike the subpar sequels that followed. Released in 1984, Children of the Corn follows a physician and his girlfriend who drive across the Midwest, only to come to a sudden halt when they encounter the body of a murdered boy in the road. The couple wander into a small town, only to discover it's populated by children, and only children, who are followers of a sinister young preacher named Isaac. Now the first half of the film plays out like any classic horror movie, however it's the homicidal children twist that makes the movie so fantastic. Not only do they worship the aforementioned preacher, but also a deity known as He Who Walks Behind the Rose, which in itself is enough to make any seasoned horror fan squeal in terror. If you enjoy cults and murderous children, this is the film for you. It's also got Sarah Connor in it. I say Sarah Connor because I can't quite remember her name right now. In at 4, It Chapter 1. Now in the grand scheme of things, It Chapter 1 is definitely unnerving, but compared to the top 3 numbers we have coming up, it's not that scary. Released in 2017, It follows 7 young outcasts in Derry, Maine, who face the worst nightmare of their lives when an ancient, shape-shifting entity emerges from the sewers to prey on the town's children. Pennywise the Clown. An entity that hails from the deadlights and emerges every 27 years to feast, and feast it does. It is packaged as a coming-of-age story, but it's so much more than that. Bill Skarsgård in full Pennywise attire is perhaps one of the most unsettling things to grace our screens, and although he's no Tim Curry, I personally believe this depiction is far more terrifying. I know, shots fired. Not to mention the film kicks off with a haunting start when poor little Georgie is chasing his paper boat down the street, only to watch it slip into the drain, and what happens next will make you cry and scream. Now the terror of this film itself lies within our personal terror for the children, innocents who are forced to grow up fast in order to take down an evil entity plaguing their small town. Coming in at 3, Misery. You may be surprised to know that only one Stephen King adaptation has ever won an Academy Award, and that is Misery, with Kathy Bates taking home an Oscar for her role as the mentally disturbed nurse who kidnaps her favorite author. Misery is absolutely terrifying, just because of the simple fact that Annie Wilkes, played by Bates, could quite literally be anyone. She is portrayed at first as endearing, naive, and good-intentioned. She appears to be a woman that would give you the shirt off her back, yet halfway through the movie, her true colors are revealed. She is mentally unstable with an unhealthy obsession, and will do absolutely anything to get what she wants, even break a few ankles in the process. Annie Wilkes could be your next door neighbor, and that's what makes her so effective, and to top it off, there are so many heart-stopping moments that will leave you holding your breath. In at 2, Carrie. Perhaps one of my favorite Stephen King adaptations of all time, Carrie, released back in 1976, is the very first Stephen King adaptation, and is still regarded as one of the best. The film follows a withdrawn and sensitive teen, Carrie, played by Sissy Spacek, who faces unrelenting taunting from classmates at school and abuse from her religious mother at home. When strange things begin to occur, Carrie starts to suspect that she has supernatural powers. Now, in many ways, Carrie is just as sad as it is scary, with one of the most iconic scenes, not just in the film but in cinema as a whole, showing Carrie getting pig's blood dumped on her at prom as she's on stage accepting prom queen. It's one of horror's greatest sequences simply because it shows a young woman coming into her power. Carrie is utterly terrifying and unique in the sense that you're never quite sure if you're rooting for the hero or the villain, with Carrie blurring the lines between the two. And finally, coming in at number 1, Dr. Sleep. Now this is the only film on our list that has yet to be released, with the movie hitting the big screens in the next few weeks. However, many are holding it to a high standard already, especially considering the plot and the people behind it. Dr. Sleep is based on the 2013 Stephen King novel of the same name, and is a sequel to King's 1977 novel, The Shining. Yeah, that's huge. huge. The film is set several decades after the events of The Shining and combines elements of the original film and the novel. Now, the film itself is directed by none other than Mike Flanagan, who appeared earlier on our list, and stars Ewan McGregor as Danny Torrance, a man with psychic powers who is struggling with his childhood traumas. Of course, any fan of The Shining will be excited for this adaptation, considering we get to revisit one of the greatest and scariest movies ever made, and we get to hold on to a beloved character who survived something truly terrifying. Stephen King wrote Dr. Sleep since he wondered what Danny Torrance would be like all grown up, and director Mike Flanagan stated that Danny is so traumatized by what he's been through, he has no idea how to deal with it. Personally, I think this film is going to be fantastic, and will bring to life some of the lost souls we met all the way back in 1980. Well, there we have it. Do you guys agree with our list? Were there any Stephen King movies that we missed? Leave us all your thoughts and feelings in the comments down below. Before I go though, I just want to respond to a few comments from one of our last videos. Top 10 horror movie actors you won't believe what they look like in real life. What a title. Terrence Olive said, "Of all the great lists that you have hosted, I believe this is my favorite." Wow, that is a very bold statement. Thank you so much. It's because I confused you with the title. Lynn Bell said, "Hey Lucy, I completely agree with you that Leatherface from 1974 is the best Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie. I do have a question though. Joss is in the opening sequence of every list, but you're not in it. Why not? You're both awesome, so you both deserve your moment in the spotlight." I actually had no idea that Joss was in the opening, but now that I know, someone has some explaining to do. Big time. I'm gonna remove Joss and put myself in it. Silver's Play said, "Lucy, love you." Love you. I made that sound weird. Love you. Rob Christian said, "Love the horror videos, Lucy. I'm glad we have a lot, and I mean a lot more coming your way, so I hope you enjoy them." And on that note, if you haven't already, be sure to give this video a big thumbs up, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you never miss another Beyond the Screen vid. And until next time, see you later.